got shot real quick.
Does that bother you? You want me to hide the picture?
No. Okay. You ask me why I'm thankful, why I sing and shout. You ask me why I'm thankful in a world that's full of doubt. You ask me what it is I found that makes me feel this way. I found it at the mourner's bench when I began to pray. That is why I'm thankful, that's why I sing and shout. God put something in my heart that I can shout about. I'm thankful God, you heard my prayer and answered me one day. I'm thankful God, you saved me in that good old-fashioned way. They told me about a man who walked the shores of Galilee, who opened up the blinded eyes of men that could not see. They told me that he healed the sick and made the dumb to talk. He also said unto the lame, take up thy bed and walk. That is why thankful, that's why I sing and shout. God put something in my heart that I can shout about. I'm thankful God, you heard my prayer and answered me one day. I'm thankful God, you saved me in that good old-fashioned way.
How many years have you folks been singing these songs now?
Three.
Remember when I first brought the guitar to your shop and I started singing songs?
Mm-hmm.
And you said, you ought to have them on paper. Well, we did it.
There they are.
Anyone else got a favorite?
Yes, I've never been sorry in here. I've never been sorry.
No. Well, we can do that one.
Okay.
Can we do this one?
It's in the hymn book.
Okay.
Can we do it this morning? I think I was thinking about doing it.
We sure don't sing Page A very much.
Page what?
Page A.
Yeah, we do, but someone ain't here.
Oh, that's what you're going to say today.
Who could it be that's not here that would know that we didn't sing Page A?
I'm glad we're on the right page.
What page is that?
Page A.
That's page U.
You, we're on page U.
No, page U. Paging... Pastor Victor.
You page if you want. But I'm already here.
Oh,
page you. Huh? Yeah, that's what she said. Page you.
Ever since Jesus saved and parted, I have been singing every day. Blessed holy name, through the dark shadows he is with me, leading me on the upward way.
I've never been sorry.
Praise the Lord. Blessed holy name.
I've never been sorry.
Praise the Lord.
That I trust in his name.
Blessed holy name.
I've never been
Next. All the way over to page A.
That's the one.
Yeah, I thought it was. Or I'll be. I care not today what tomorrow may bring, if shadow or sunshine or rain. The Lord I know ruleth for everything, and all of my worry is vain. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding. Clouds arise, obscuring the brightness of light. I'm never alarmed at the overcast skies. The Master looks on at the sky. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love. Come on. I know that He safely will carry me through, no matter what evils betide. Why should I then care though the tempest may blow, if Jesus walks close to my side? Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love. From all of our sin, in His sheltering arms, I'm living by faith, and I feel no alarm. Our Lord will return to this earth some sweet day. Our troubles will then all be o'er. The Master so gently will lead us away beyond that blessed heavenly shore. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love. From all of our sheltering arms, I'm living by faith, and feel no alarm. Praise God!
Praise Woo! God.
Anybody else? Good morning, Brent. I thought, you know, it's a good thing he's not sitting underneath the fan. He could have had his head chopped off.
I just want to thank you, Lord, or God's coloring book. Or...
How about page 3? Jesus pilots my ship.
All right, Jesus pilots my ship.
You sure he's not the co-pilot?
Nope.
Oh, no, I want to sit in the back seat. All the way in the back.
The soul of man is like a ship that sails the sea of time. The storms may come, the winds may blow, and rock this ship of mine. But the reason my ship will never sink, and today is still afloat, my will be sorry, please, no more, unless Jesus leads the way. I will never trip so far from shore, I can't hear what he has to say. I belong to a fleet that sailed today, I'm a glorious one which way. I went safely on shore, sail no more, for Jesus pilot my ship. My soul pulled into safety's port, my stern all torn apart. The bow of my vessel so badly crushed, sends waters flooding my heart. I have sailed so long on life's angry waves, with my cargo of fear and despair. Then I called on his name and he lifted away, now he pilots my ship everywhere. I won't sail these shore seas no more unless Jesus leads the way. I won't ever drift so far from shore, I can hear what he has to say. I belong to a fleet that sails today, I'm a glorious one-way trip. I'll land safely on shore to sail no more, for Jesus pilots my ship.
Why you, little Brent, you got a favorite? Why you, Miss Felicia?
How about I just want to thank you, Lord.
Okay.
For making the sun to shine, putting the stars in the sky, for the flowers that bloom, the ocean so blue. Thank you, Lord, for the birds that sing. They make a sweet melody, for the rivers that flow, the rain and the snow. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank Lord, I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. Thank you, Lord, I just want to thank you, Lord, I just want to thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for my home. For life's joys that you've given me, for shoes at my feet, plenty to eat. Thank you, Lord, for the church where I worship and pray, for the freedom that I have today. Sweet Spirit, I feel your presence so real. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Saving my soul. Giving my sad heart cheer, for holding my hand when I could not stand. Thank you, Lord, for giving your life for me on the cross of Calvary, for taking my place in mercy and grace. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done for me. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Yes. What is that?
Leave your heavy burden at the cross.
Okay, that's the last page, I think, right?
You know, I sure do miss Brother Greg and Brandon when they're not here. I sure wish they were here.
Amen. Do you bear away the sins and you have no peace within? And it seems like your life is but a loss. You can find a sweet relief and a joy for every grief if you leave your heavy burden at the cross. I believe I felt the Spirit of God in our singing.
I believe the same.
Okay, take your Bibles, please. Turn to Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5. I didn't say Hosea. I didn't say Habakkuk. And I most certainly did not say Hezekiah.
No, that's just a character in the book.
Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 12. For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not strong meat. Let's pray. Lord, you're a wonderful God. Thank you for the Bible, Lord God. And Lord, please help us to draw closer to you, to be better Christians, Lord God. And I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Title of this message is called Bible 101 or Bible Advance. Bible 101 Or you know what 101 is? You know what Bible 101 would be? Beginner's Bible courses. Okay? Now, fortunately, you have been here in church for a little while. So, in knowledge, you are not in Bible 101 anymore. Now, many churches are in Bible 101, and a lot of people stay in Bible. There's nothing wrong with Bible 101. Nothing wrong with it at all. But if you've been saved a while, you ought to be more than Bible 101. You ought to have some advanced courses in there. Bible advanced courses. Now you notice here in this text, we have people, there are people who want to be teachers of the word, but they haven't gone past Bible 101. Bible 101 is the milk of the word. I got a Catholic guy on Facebook. I don't know why he friended me. I put this verse on here for him because he's trying to teach all these things. And I said, hey, you don't even have salvation because no Catholic is saved. And here you're trying to teach advanced courses in the Bible. It doesn't work. You got to get born again first, get the milk of the word, and then you're able to teach. After you got the milk of the word down, then you're able to teach the strong meat. But if you don't have the milk of the word down, you think you're going to have the strong meat correct? Of course not. What's going to happen? They're going to be teaching Bible verses out of context. That's why it says, you need one to teach you again. Which be the first principles and the oracles of God. The main teaching, the oracles, the main teachings. The principles. What is the principles of our faith? So I got three things down here that many churches, many Christians stay in Bible 101. Some shouldn't even be in Bible 101, but in some areas, but they're there. And they stay there. But I only have three areas that I'm going to teach on tonight about Bible 101. The first one is about heaven. Heaven. In Bible 101, Christians teach and believe, Christians go to heaven and live there forevermore. We even have some songs in our red book that say that. I got no problem with it. I got no problem saying these things as long as you understand there's more to it than that in an advanced Bible. Now, I've given everyone here a summary on the book of Revelation, and then plus that pattern on the back, that diagram on the back, should show you the whole picture. What does that show? It shows if we die right now, we'd go to heaven. But what's going to happen after that? The second coming of Christ. What's going to happen after that? It's more than just going to heaven and living happily ever after, although we are going to live happily ever after. It's just there's more information the Bible gives us than that. That's Bible 101. And in Bible advance, there is heaven, the second coming, the thousand-year reign of Christ, where God is going to remake the heavens and the earth. So it's still going to be a sun in the sky. And none of that's going to get remade. What's going to get remade is the earth. The earth is going to go back to, say, the Garden of Eden type thing. All over it's going to be like that. Okay? And that's where we as Christians will rule and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. Those who make it through the tribulation period, which is not going to be a whole lot of people, but there are going to be people that make it, are going to be on earth when it changes into a remade earth. That's the people who will live, if they die at 100 years old, it's like a young child died, because lifespan is going to be extended for the natural people left on this earth. Well, what's going to happen after that? What happens after the 1,000-year reign? Well, you got the Battle of Gog and Magog. I'm not gagging when I say that. What the Bible calls Gog and Magog. Okay? Here's where a lot of people get messed up. Because there are places in Ezekiel that talk about this battle. And I think mostly in Ezekiel. And they think that is what's going to happen in the tribulation period. That's why they think that the armies are going to go against Israel and that Jesus is going to come and save Israel. Okay? But that's not what happens in tribulation. That's what happens after the millennium. That's when you read Revelation, in Revelation chapter 20, before Judgment Day, before the Great White Throne, it talks about the Battle of Gog and Magog. And that's where it is. You see? So advanced Bible, see, we're learning a lot more than just we go to heaven and live forever. What happens after the Battle of Gog and Magog? Anybody know? Anybody know? Any guesses? I just said it. I put a little few pieces here and there. It said the Great White Throne Judgment. Heaven and earth flee away. And we're all, at least all the saved people first, is standing at the Great White Throne Judgment. We're judged. And then the resurrection of the unjust. And they're judged. What happens after Judgment Day? A brand spanking new heaven and earth. There's no more sun in that heaven. There's no more death on earth. Jesus is the light there. Okay? Jesus and God the Father are the light. There's no more sun in heaven. And that's how. And there's no more death. And at that time is when God wipes away all tears. Okay, so we learned here that in talking about heaven, those in Bible 101, they believe what? What's that?
You go to heaven and that's it.
And that's it. We go to heaven, we're with Jesus, and that's where we live forevermore. But in Bible Advance, it's heaven, the second coming, the 1,000-year reign of Christ, the Battle of Gog and Magog, Judgment Day, and a brand new heaven and earth. As Bible Advance. Now, like I said, there's nothing wrong with singing songs about Bible 101 heaven. Nothing wrong with that at all. As long as we understand, there's more to it because our understanding, we know more than Bible 101 teaches about heaven. Okay? So that's there's in heaven, about the teaching of heaven, in Bible 101, Beginner's Bible, and Advanced Bible. The sad thing is in most churches, all they get on this subject, they could be there for 10, 20, 30 years, and all they're going to get on this subject is Bible 101. That's all. Is that right, Bonita?
That's right.
We ought to know. We've been in churches for a long time. Even the hardcore churches that preach hard, that's as far as they go. Bible 101 there. The next subject is repentance and holy living. Repentance and holy living. Those in Bible 101 know nothing about it whatsoever. In a lot of churches, many people are in Bible 101, Beginner's Bible, concerning the subject, repentance and living a holy life. Now, there are some other denominations that they stress this point, and it's too bad those who usually stress the point believe you can lose your salvation. And that's why they stress it. Okay? But Bible 101, they know nothing about repentance and living a holy life. advanced Bible concerning repentance and living a holy life. Jesus said in Mark 8:35, now, so you ought to remember some of these things, because if someone asks you a question, you're trying to teach someone, you'll know where to go with these, okay? Mark 8, sorry, Mark 8 for that. And there's other verses that are similar in other Gospels. Jesus said, for whosoever, in Mark 8:35, for whosoever will save his life will lose it. But whosoever will lose his life for my sake in the Gospels, the same shall save it. So you see, it's die to yourself, live for Jesus Christ. In John, he says it this way. Whosoever loveth his life is going to lose it, and whosoever hateth his life will find it unto life eternal. You see? So there's a dying on our part that has to take place for repentance. We die to ourselves. We die to our own wants. In Bible 101, they know nothing about this. And all there's, as we've been through Bible studies and Proverbs and different places in the Bible, we see that there are many verses that imply dying to yourself, repenting of your sins, not going your way anymore. In Romans 6:4, it's put like this, knowing that our old man is crucified, that's our old nature, is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. And it says, being buried with him by baptism into death, dying to ourselves, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. In Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ, which liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, because, you know, I'm not a glorified body yet. It doesn't say the life which I now live after the flesh. That's two different things. But the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by what, Brother Brent?
By faith.
Living by faith. I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. The same book, Galatians chapter 5, verse 24, says that they that are Christ's have crucified the affections and desires of the flesh. You see that one verse is saying? Just in that one short verse, it's saying, you're not Christ's if you did not crucify the lust of the flesh, basically. See, it's right in one verse. And I'm talking about people that read the Bible. These people try to read through the Bible every year. You know, it's a goal of theirs. But are they understanding what they're reading? No. They're still, why don't they understand what they're reading? Because they're not questioning what they're reading. They're just reading the words. They couldn't explain it to you. They're still in Bible 101. And then in Galatians 6:8, it talks about you're going to sow what you reap. If you sow to your flesh, you're going to reap corruption, which is hell. But if you sow to the Spirit, you're going to reap life everlasting. See? How do I know corruption is talking about hell? Because the flip-flop of that verse is talking about everlasting life. So corruption has to be speaking about hell. Okay? So, we covered, first subject was heaven, Bible 101 and advanced Bible. Second subject, repentance and living a holy life. What does living a holy life mean? It means not living worldly. You're set apart. You're living for God, set apart for God. Worldly groups are not going to affect how you look. With the tattoos, with the earrings, the guy with the earrings, okay? Long hair on men. We know that's the world's Jesus. Okay? And so therefore, we don't conform to the world. We conform to the Bible. That's a key to the strong meat. I'm going to show you that at the end. The last subject I want to talk about between Bible 101 and Bible Advanced is hell. I'm talking about in the independent Baptist churches, the ones who are the closest what the Bible teaches, the churches I recommend people to go to. In some independent fundamental Baptist churches, they're still in Bible 101 concerning hell, concerning easy believism. Why? Because easy believism, it's against the repentance and holy living of a life. Why is that? Because in easy believism, this is my definition for it. No repentance, no assurance, no evidence, salvation. So you know what that means? You can't tell who's saved. If they're living a wicked life, they might be saved. And I even take it as far with these people say, so Hitler could have been saved killing all them people, right? That's right. You need to study the Bible a little bit harder. And because that is not taught from cover to cover. The opposite of that is taught from cover to cover. So, easy believism is no repentance. In other words, you don't have to repent of your sins to get saved. Oh, that's works, salvation. Also, it's no assurance. You know why? Because most people, some people in easy believism already have a repentant heart, so they get saved. Okay? But those who don't have a repentant heart and they pray the sinner's prayer and they think they're saved, they have no assurance that they're saved. They try to show them Bible verses. Now look, see this Bible verse? This says you're saved, so just believe what it says. But they don't have the indwelling of the Spirit of God to give them the true assurance that, yes, I know I'm saved because I got the Spirit of God. Okay? So it's no repentance, no assurance, and no evidence. You cannot tell. A person's not going to have fruit showing that they're saved. That's the no evidence. So I call easy believism. There's no repentance, no assurance, no evidence, salvation. Which is really no salvation at all. Okay? So that is one aspect of hell in Bible 101 concerning easy believism. Advanced Bible teaches many who call Jesus Lord are only giving lip service and will be in hell. Now, can anybody think of a verse to back this up? A couple verses?
You know, many
a reference? That,
many,
reference?
Oh, the reference? I know the verse. Many will say in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not done?
Let's turn it because I want to see this. Matthew chapter 7. And see, sometimes I hit the same subjects, but I'm hitting them at different angles. And, you know, we're going to learn these verses. We're going to learn these places. And we'll be able to show people these things, and we'll fully understand it. Hopefully, you know, people that come to church here get a good understanding of it. Matthew chapter 7, starting at verse 21. Matthew 7:21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. What is he saying? Not everyone that calls me Lord is going to heaven.
That's right.
But who is in the context of this? But he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. There's the evidence. It's not just calling him Lord, but there's evidence you're doing the will of the Father. Let's continue. Jesus explains a little bit further on it. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name have done many wonderful works? So, they do not know Jesus, and they think they're doing the will of the Father, And they're active in church, it looks like. But they're not saved. And why are they not saved? They're doing some works. But you know what's missing here? Repentance. And I'll show you repentance is missing. They're doing good works, but look at verse 23. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, who? Yes. So, in other words, you're doing these works for me, right? You are prophesying in my name, Jesus says. You are casting out devils in my, or they say it, in Jesus' name. They've done many wonderful works, but you know what? There's no repentance here. They're doing this living in sin. You know what that means? See, there are, just this right here is totally against easy believism, right here. These two verses are totally against easy believism. Totally. Blows it out of the water. But you know, there are people in easy believism that believe it. Read this. They read these verses here. Why don't they get it? You know why? Because they're still in Bible 101. They're not trying to see what the Bible's trying to teach. They're satisfied what they learned at Bible college or what their church teaches. And so everything has to fit into their belief box. And some things are really cramming it in there too, trying to get it to fit, but it really don't fit. It's like trying to put a circle around a square peg. And they're trying to hammer it on there to get it to fit. It ain't going to fit. Okay, so we covered what? Heaven. Bible 101 about heaven and advanced Bible about heaven. Repentance and living a holy life. Bible 101 and advanced. We covered hell. One aspect of hell that a lot of churches have a problem with, and that's easy believism. Okay? And they're going to be in that hell that they preach about because of their easy believism, because they never repented. Okay, that's what that shows there. I want us to go back to our text verse for this lesson in Hebrews chapter 5. Because we want to make sure we're getting the context of this too. And let's read verse 12 again. Hebrews chapter 5, starting at verse 12. But we're going to go all the way down to the end of the chapter there. Two more verses. For when, for the time, ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles and the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word. See that? Those who use only milk are unskillful because they don't understand it. Why? Because they only use milk. And it says in the word of righteousness, why? For he is a babe. It doesn't mean he's a baby Christian. He's a babe in understanding. Verse 14. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. What is that saying? That's saying that those that are in strong meat obey the Bible. And because they obey the Bible, their senses are exercised, they can discern what's right and wrong. But those that are in milk only can have no discernment. They cannot discern what the Bible is trying to teach. They're in Bible 101. When you're in Bible 101 and you're only drinking milk, you got the understanding of a baby, and trying to understand the Bible, how are you going to teach what the Bible's trying to teach? Cannot be done. So, there's nothing wrong with using milk of the word. Nothing wrong for us using that. But, as long as we have the understanding of the meat, strong meat, what is verse by verse by verse, understanding verse by verse by verse what the Bible is trying to say, that's a strong meat. And then obeying it is exercising in it. So, now this does not mean that if we are using strong meat, that we look down on people that are still in Bible 101. The Bible says knowledge puffeth up. Okay? And we got to make sure we don't get puffed up about it. But we need to understand that those that are only in Bible 101, that's as far as they go, they're hurting themselves. They're only hurting themselves. And they cannot have, listen, the more Bible you understand, the more joy you're going to have. Is that not right? And when you really understand what's going to happen in the end time, you understand God is going to make a new heaven and earth and, you know, and all that. You try to tell that to someone in Bible 101. They'll think you're a Jehovah's Witness. If you say, eventually God's going to make a new heaven and earth and that's what we're going to live on. If they ever confront Jehovah, they're going to think you're a Jehovah's Witness because they don't know the Bible. Why? Because they're still a babe. They're still in Bible 101, at least in that area. So let's not get puffed about our knowledge, but guess what? If people come to church here, they're getting advanced Bible. Will they be still getting some Bible? Some Bible 101, yes. Because... hey, little babes need to feed on milk. You cannot feed a little baby a steak, can you?
No.
What's going to happen? Little baby don't have any teeth and you're just trying to feed him steak? It's not going to work so well. But once that baby gets teeth and starts growing, and you're starting able to give him a little bit of meat here and there, hey, he's nurturing on meat. Now he's on the meat. Does he still drink milk once in a while? Yeah, he does. If he can, as long as he's healthy enough. So, Lord, you're a wonderful God. Thank you for our little lesson tonight, dear Lord. Please bless his time and please bless Brent and his family, Lord God. And help us all to draw closer to you. Help us to use this knowledge, Lord God, to win others to thee. And for our own joy also, Lord God. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, you are missing something in Revelation. And we're going through some good stuff, verse by verse, in Revelation. Yeah.